Hey there, Dr. Jennifer West here, and we're going to be covering brachycephalic airway syndrome today because it's something that frequently owners don't even know that their pet has. Brachy stands for short. Cephalic stands for of or relating to the head. So what we're talking about is short-faced dogs or cats. Classic cats include Persians, so the cats that have like the really flat face. Classic dogs include English Bulldogs, French Bulldogs, Pekingese, Pugs, any dog that has a much shorter muzzle does have a higher risk of having brachycephalic airway disease or syndrome. What does this mean? So the nasal passages, the breathing, upper airway breathing passages are going to be shortened and flattened. Just inherently, anatomically, if you have a short muzzle, a short face, the airways are also shorter. But it doesn't mean there's less tissue. The tissue is just kind of flattened and pushed in. So the symptoms are the actual signs that you'll see at home for your dog may include what you think is just normal bulldog breathing. A lot of people say that's just how they breathe. So they have had one their whole life or they've been around them and they hear them breathing. And you can hear them from far away sometimes. Many, many dogs that have this short muzzle, you hear, because all of that tissue and all of that extra force that they're trying to inhale and exhale, we hear that, call that stridor if you hear a loud noise on inhale, or stertor if it's more like a snore or a loud exhalation. That means there is added pressure. This upper airway pressure can cause some serious side effects, and the fact that they're struggling that much to breathe can predispose them to a serious crisis. And so this is a really important topic. There are ways to prevent that crisis that are much more safe than waiting until it's a big deal. And even though these dogs are super cute, awesome pups, you wanna, of course, make sure that we're addressing their different diseases and different conditions before it's an emergency. So what are the actual issues going on here? As I said, they have the smushed face. They have stenotic nares. So the nose is actually kind of smushed in. It may not be fully, but at least a little bit. You'll kind of see that there are two little flaps on each side are occluding and preventing flow in through their nose during breathing. So these stenotic nares get in the way. The next area is their soft palate. The palate's the top of their mouth inside. So the soft palate happens, it's first hard palate and then soft palate's behind that. It extends in so far because it's overgrown that it occludes a structure called the epiglottis. The epiglottis is just this flap that covers the windpipe. So the windpipe, the trachea, goes down to the lungs, and this epiglottis is closed when food comes in so that food's not going down the trachea, and opens up to let air in. The issue with this overlong soft palate is it obstructs. It gets in the way of that epiglottis opening and closing, and it doesn't allow air to fully come in. And it causes dogs to panic. If they are already struggling to breathe, that can become a heightened another issue. The third common finding with these animals is that they can have everted laryngeal saccules. The laryngeal saccules live in the mouth. They're close to the vocal cords that help dogs vocalize, bark, make all their noises. And they basically are protruding into the airway. So again, a structure in the way of normal air movement. One other finding that some dogs may have is a hypoplastic trachea. So just a poorly developed trachea. The cartilage in their neck just isn't fully open. Again, all of this pressure, all of that effort makes it harder for the airway to stay open. So at home, animals, or coming into the hospital, animals may present showing, again, those loud noises with breathing. And as they become a bit more distressed and start getting more concerned that they can't breathe, it can progress. So you can see that they'll start really having blue tongue and blue gums because they're not oxygenating. They're not getting enough air in, even though they're trying. They start to hyperventilate. They start to really pant, get worked up, overexert themselves. And in a really severe case, they may collapse. They may actually have a fainting episode or a syncopal event because they cannot get enough oxygen to the brain. And so the body kind of shuts down. ways to prevent that are honestly surgery. Surgery is a way, it's much safer than waiting for your pup to go into one of these crises, because it doesn't have to happen when they're young. Just because your dog has made it to 7-8 years old, we frequently see animals that as they age, this process becomes worse. The trachea has been worked for a very long time, and all this added pressure can cause this to worsen. Additionally, being overweight, a dog that gets heftier, it's more pressure and more weight they're lugging around, and it's a lot harder for them to get around. You'll notice at home these dogs can become exercise intolerant. You're on a standard walk, especially on a hot day, and they start getting overexerted. They start needing oxygen and having a lot more trouble than they should if they were healthy and normal. Now, the tricky part becomes, this is not your breeder's fault. This is not your dog's fault. It is not your fault. It's just how this happened, how they were bred, that they do have this syndrome. And the best way, as I said, is to go ahead with this surgery. So what surgery involves? According to the American College of Veterinary Surgeons, and certainly a specialty surgeon typically performs this surgery, they will use laser or surgery to remove part of these nares. So they'll either use laser to remove that little sac, the areas that are stenotic, or they'll even do little wedges here to just open up the nose. They'll trim the soft palate, and they'll also remove those laryngeal saccules and possibly the tonsils to help open up the airway more. So consult with your veterinarian, talk about this. This is a surgery that sometimes can be done at the same time as a neuter. So it's one anesthesia event, but it depends on a whole lot of factors. And again, it's just something where I would, as an owner, prefer to do a preventative procedure than wait until it's an emergency, because at that point, the airway and the mouth and everything is going to be inflamed, and it will be more of a crisis situation. I hope that helps clarify things, and I hope that your pups and your kitties are all doing great. Thank you.